dimensional tiering, probably the most controversial, misunderstood, and hard to research concepts in powerscaling. We often use this when attempting to grasp the true scale of certain fictional characters that can either destroy time-space continuums, or better yet, exist in higher realms even beyond our own comprehension. And by the end of this video, you'll find out that dimensional tiering is actually much simpler than you may have originally thought. So without further ado, let's get straight into it. So, some of you may be asking, well, what is dimensional tiering? Well, dimensional tiering is the type of scaling that doesn't ignore the differences between dimensional quantities. Or in other words, to dimensionally tier something is to take into account how many dimensions the thing occupies. So for example, if a character destroyed a tesseract, also known as a hypercube, using dimensional tiering, this would be a fourth dimensional feat, since tesseracts, or hypercubes, are defined by being fourth dimensional. So why does this difference matter? Well, let me give you an example to show you how important this difference is. Let's take a square with a length and a width of one unit. This square is a true two-dimensional object, and thus has absolutely no height at all. And if we compare it to a cube with at least one in length, width, and height, how many squares could we fit into the cube? Well, the square has no height or zero height, so even an infinite amount of squares stacked on top of each other still wouldn't make a cube. So to ignore dimensionality is to ignore just how many squares the cube can fit within it. This is the same problem of how many zeros are needed to be added together to reach one. To go in reverse of how many squares this cube-level person can destroy, we have to talk about ways to measure energy, which would be in joules. A joule is when a force of one unit, which is when an object of 1 kilogram has an acceleration of 1 meter per second, acts on that object in the direction of the force's motion through a distance of 1 meter. So joules are in part defined by a weight. Obviously, something like a 1 by 1 by 1 meter cube of rock has a solvable weight, but for a perfectly flat square, this is less obvious. It doesn't even really make sense to apply a weight to something that is similar to the number of zeros needed to reach one. A weight, like a kilogram, is exclusively a three-dimensional measurement, which means that normal joule values cannot be applied to higher or lower dimensioned objects without producing ridiculous results like beyond infinite joules, which isn't very useful. A point is a zero-dimensional object. A line is a one-dimensional object. Something like a square is 2D, and something like a cube is 3D. But how do we deal with objects with more than three dimensions? And what even is a fourth dimensional object? Well, to start talking about objects with more than three dimensions, we can look back at our good old friends, the square and the cube. With how many squares can be stacked into the cube, or how many zeros are needed to reach one, we need to understand that the difference between a cube and a hypercube or tesseract are the same. It's important to know here that this difference has nothing to do with time, which a lot of people misconstrue as the fourth dimension, or something similar. Taking time away from a cube wouldn't make it any easier to destroy, and time as a rate of change doesn't really follow the structure that we have laid out here as the next step beyond a cube. What we mean here by 4D is an axis or coordinate of space beyond the usual three. It's hard to understand what this is like because we don't seem to perceive dimensions beyond three. It doesn't even really make sense to say something like the fourth or the third dimension. There's nothing special about each dimension. They are all just lines at different angles, even if these angles are pretty extreme. We can only really talk about an object or a space having two or three or whatever number of dimensions. In this sense, it doesn't work to count time amongst these either because it is known to be very different from any of the others, which are all identical. And there also isn't really any reason to think of it as the fourth. A purely square world could have time and a rate of change. So we could describe 2D objects as having area, 3D objects as having volume, and a 4D object would have something called hypervolume. So what about even higher dimensions? Well, we can do this extension from a cube to a hypercube any number of times. Literally, pick any number you want, and that object or space could have that many dimensions, and it would be superior to each previous dimensioned object or space following the same pattern. Even infinite dimensional objects or spaces are fine, and real-life ways of calculating these even exist, like with something known as a Hilbert space, which can account for infinite dimensions. People often refer to 12 dimensions or any other finite number higher as hyperversal. Then infinite dimensions and beyond is known as high hyperversal. We can extend this dimensional difference principle to any extent that we like, and objects or spaces that go completely beyond any extent of dimensions we call low outerversal. Actually, the difference between low outerversal and high hyperversal is bigger even than the difference between a 3D object and a high hyperversal one. To give you an idea of how impressive this is, despite popular belief, you can't simply reach the tier of low outerversal by simply stacking infinite dimensions on top of each other and then some, as low outerversal would be beyond the restrictions of dimensionality in total. So that's low outerversal. What would be the qualifications for baseline outerversal? Well, outerversal, not low outerversal, is being above the concept of spatial dimensionality. Which then begs the question, what even is a concept, and why would it matter here? A concept can mean many, many different things, but in this case, a concept of something refers to some kind of abstract object or rule that is superior to all aspects of that particular notion, and makes the thing that it's about even possible in the first place. For example, the concept of an apple, in this particular meaning of the term concept, would be superior to all possible apples, and would be the thing that makes those apples even possible at all. So in this case, being beyond the concept of dimensionality is more impressive because this is what makes it possible for dimensionality or space to occur in the first place. This is why the specification is important, as it doesn't equate to simply being beyond space. As with additional context, it could easily be referring to something being beyond a 3D space, which would make you 4D, or being beyond 4D space, which would make you 5D, etc. The point here is that something simply being beyond space is vague and lacks the predictive power to definitively mean something like being beyond the concepts of space would. Additionally, the concept of space would also encompass all dimensionality, as dimension space is merely a type of space. Which then brings us to high outerversal, which is simply being beyond an outerversal thing to the same extent that a normal outerversal thing is beyond normal human beings. Now, hypothetically, we could invent tiers above this, but for the sake of the video, high outerversal includes everything above this. Now that we've talked about what is actually beyond dimensionality, we can now talk about things that aren't, such as transfinite amount of dimensions. Obviously, by having a specific amount of dimensions means you are still bound by dimensionality. So, hypothetically, you define a tier as having aleph null dimensions. That would be less impressive than someone who is unbound by dimensionality, and also just wouldn't be what we defined as outerversal instead of being higher into what we would call high outerversal. I should also mention that simply having a transfinite number mentioned doesn't really mean anything. In order to actually be useful, it has to relate to an amount of things, be it planets, universes, dimensions, etc. Lastly, I'd like to mention that you can have higher dimensioned or even beyond dimensioned AP without the existence of being on that level. So, a character could be 3D in size while still affecting things with more than 3 dimensions. There's really no reason to say this can't be the case unless you decide to read a page wrong. Well, anyway, that's it for my dimensional tiering video. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you're wondering what the next video is going to be, it's not going to be some video listing off all the tiers, but instead, it's going to be about what even is a tiering system and what it exactly entails to use one. If you guys want me to talk about each individual tier, I was thinking of covering them both as a YouTube short and a TikTok, which you should go give a follow, by the way, as I will often post short videos on there in between these long and elaborate YouTube videos. But please do let me know if this is what you guys want in my comments. I would also like to give a massive thank to my two friends Hashi and Webcamparrot in the creation of this script. Trust me when I say, if it wasn't for them, this video wouldn't be possible. But until then, thank you all for watching, and class is dismissed.